मैम कैन वी स्टार्ट?
यस मैम स्टार्ट।
पेशेंट नेम्ड एक्स वाई जेड, 15 इयर्स, अ बॉय बॉर्न टू फर्स्ट बॉर्न टू नॉन कंसंग्विनियस पेरेंट्स, रिसाइडिंग एट केआर मार्केट बैंगलोर, हिंदू बाय रिलीजन, सेल्फ इन्फॉर्मेंट एंड इज रिलायबल एंड वॉज एडमिटेड टू आर हॉस्पिटल ऑन 6th ऑफ दिस मंथ एंड एग्जामिंड ऑन 6th. He has come with complaints of fever with productive cough since which we had 2 weeks back. After that, he has developed tingling sensation over the feet for 3 days, weakness in both the lower limbs for 2 days. History of presenting illness. A 15-year-old boy was apparently normal 2 weeks back when he developed sudden onset, high grade intermittent fever, child being active in the interfebrile period, which lasted for about 3 days. Fever was associated with cough with moderate expectoration, yellow colored sputum, non-foul smelling, non-blood tinged, and that as well relieved in 5 days. It was not associated with chills and rigors. There was no complaints of pain abdomen, loose stools, vomiting, or burning micturition. No history of irritability, headache, neck stiffness, confusion was present during the illness. The boy now complains of tingling sensation over the feet since 3 days. Sorry, ma'am, I made a mistake. Since 3 days, following which he developed weakness of both lower limbs since the past 2 days, which he noticed the morning as weakness of both the lower limbs, following which the weakness has been gradually progressive from inability to climb upstairs or downstairs, inability to get up from the floor, repeated falls on attempting to walk with twisting of the ankles, slipping of chappals, to the present stage of unable to move both the lower limbs. No difficulty in combing hair, in buttoning and unbuttoning the shirt was noticed. No difficulty in rolling over the bed, getting up from bed, raising the head and holding neck was noticed. No history of sensation or pain over the face and face and the body. No history of urinary incontinence or retention or any syncopal attacks or bladder bowel involvement present. No history of any involuntary movements were present. No history of difficulty in taking food to mouth, swaying on attempting to walk, and giddiness was present. No history of fatigability or fluctuating weakness. No history of blurring of vision, double vision, impaired sensation of smell, drooling of saliva, deviation of angle of mouth, loss of taste sensation, hearing, difficulty in swallowing, change in voice. No history of any breathing difficulty. No present history of fever, myalgia, arthralgia, ear discharge or pain, skin lesions, neck pain, irritability, seizures, or any altered sensorium. No history of pain abdomen, photosensitivity, or any skin rashes. No history of any recent trauma, wound, or consumption of improperly preserved food items or any other toxins, exposure to any other toxins or consumption of it. Child is vaccinated for polio and has not received any recent vaccination. Past
Okay.
history.
On, tell me. Go on, go on.
Okay, ma'am. Past history. No history of similar complaints in the past. No history of any other medical disorders. Treatment history. He had taken over-the-counter medications for his fever and cough 2 weeks back, details of which are not known. And
Okay.
this should be elaborate.
We'll analyze the current problem. After that, we'll go to the antenatal. Was there anything relevant in the
No, ma'am.
antenatal? In that case, we'll start analyzing his symptoms.
Yes, ma'am.
What do you think about his fever and cough, ma'am?
Ma'am, she had a previous infectious episode, ma'am, 2 weeks back. Following that infectious episode, now he has developed these symptoms, ma'am.
Yes, it looks like some kind of respiratory infection.
Yes, ma'am.
It is not showing any characteristic features of tuberculosis or COVID disease or such kind of things. You are not getting, he did not have any loss of smell or
Nothing.
severe respiratory distress. All those things were not there. So it looks like one kind of a common respiratory infection. What it is, we are not tied. So that we will leave it off. The first symptom is tingling sensation in the lower limbs, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Would you like to
Especially
discuss
over
that
the feet,
symptom?
ma'am.
Both feet.
Yes, both
Okay.
the feet. had that yes. after 3 days that he had, after that he developed this, ma'am.
So symptom by symptom, we will discuss, ma'am. So would you like to elaborate and tell what you understand by the tingling sensation and why you would like to localize that symptom?
Yes, ma'am. Since tingling sensation, that is mainly characteristic of posterior column involvement, ma'am.
Hmm.
So would like to localize it to the involvement of tracts, large fiber tracts, which carry the tingling sensation to the posterior column, ma'am, through the spinal root. So somewhere in the spinal nerve, large fibers of the spinal nerve, ma'am.
So if you want to go systematically, you see column and all those things, we'll decide after examination only.
Yes.
So column is in the spinal cord and yes. the proprioceptive fibers are there in the roots, it is there in the nerves, it is in the plexus, it is everywhere. So
yes.
to say that it is in the column, you have to say that my patient has got a spinal cord disease. You have to go a long way.
Yes.
Now what you are finding is a positive sensory symptom.
Hmm.
So it's a sensory symptom and it is positive.
Yes.
And what are the positive sensory symptoms and why do you localize each one of them? Enumerate some positive sensory symptoms, ma'am.
Ma'am, positive. One is loss of pain and temperature, ma'am.
That is negative, no, ma'am. Okay. You see, this is positive, no? You said tingling.
Yes, ma'am.
So you can, with every system, motor or sensory or anything, you can have positive symptoms and negative symptoms. Negative symptom indicate destruction and positive symptoms indicate irritation. So positive sensory symptoms are paresthesias, dysesthesias, hyperalgesia and hyperpedia commonly. There are many other atypical allodynia, so many things that we will have to have a discussion on sensations itself. Instead, the common sensory symptoms are paresthesia, dysesthesia, hyperpedia and hyperalgesia. So you will call this as a paresthesia, dysesthesia, hyperpedia, hyperalgesia?
This will be paresthesia, ma'am.
Very good. Why do you call it as a paresthesia?
An altered sensation he's been having.
So what do you understand by paresthesia? It is not altered sensation. You see, paresthesia is defined as sensory perception in the absence of sensory stimuli.
Okay.
So you are not touching, you are not pricking, you are not doing anything. But patient is experiencing a spontaneous sensation. So
yes.
this is a paresthesia because paresthesias are sensory perceptions in the absence of sensory stimulation. That is what your patient is having. So what is dysesthesia? Dysesthesia is what you said. Altered perception of a sensory stimuli. You touch the patient and patient is howling that you pricked him. That is dysesthesia. Diabetic patients, when their dress is touching their skin, it will burn. So they will remove their dress and keep it above the knee. That is dysesthesia. So dysesthesia is altered perception of a sensory stimuli. Paresthesia is sensory perception in the absence of a sensory stimuli. And hyperalgesia is lowered threshold for sensory appreciation. For example, if you have an abscess, even before you touch the abscess, the patient might howl. Or if you just touch also, they will get severe pain. That is lowered threshold for sensory appreciation. And hyperpedia is lowered perception, lowered threshold, high threshold for low density stimuli and low threshold for high density stimuli. That is even thalamus. For example, you press the patient or prick the patient or whatever you do, patient will say, no, no, I am not feeling anything. So you think maybe he's anesthetic and you slightly increase the sensation, then he will react much more than what he expected. That is a unique combination of elevated threshold for low pressure stimuli and exaggerated perception beyond the threshold. That unique combination is hyperpedia. So my patient is having paresthesia because he has sensory perception in the absence of sensory stimuli. So where are you going to localize the paresthesia? That is the next question.
Yes.
You went on to the posterior column. No, it's a tingling paresthesia. So what are all the types of paresthesia you can get? Can you tell me? You can get tingling paresthesia, you can get burning paresthesia, and you can get paresthesia of cold. So patient might feel episodes of chill or episodes of burning or episodes of tingling. So when you get a paresthesia of tingling, what it is happening is, you see, normally in pain transmission, large myelinated fibers are always inhibiting small myelinated fiber. You have got A delta fiber, you have got C fiber. You might have studied about gate control theory of Melsack and Wald. So there is gating throughout. We are wearing the dress all the time. So we need not be told, you are always wearing dress, you are all. But when the dress is slightly moved in position, you will be told. So that is called triaging. So filtering of unwanted stimuli from reaching the nervous system is constantly happening. So large myelinated fiber is inhibiting the small myelinated fiber constantly. So when that is poor, large myelinated fiber is unable to control the small myelinated fiber due to disease of the large myelinated fiber, or that is destructive disease of the large myelinated fiber, or irritative disease of the small myelinated fiber when it refuses to be modulated. So paresthesia is spontaneous sensation in the absence of sensory stimuli, which is due to destructive disease of the large myelinated sensory fiber or irritative disease of the small sensory fiber. You understood?
Yes, ma'am. Understood, ma'am.
So if you are asked to localize, you will tell my patient has either a destructive disease of the large sensory fiber or an irritative disease of the small fiber. Yes, that is a paresthesia. What is the pathomechanism of dysesthesia? So paresthesia is not a very good sign. It is a sign of ongoing disease. Whereas dysesthesia is, you are touching the patient. So altered perception of a sensory stimuli. The mechanism underlying that is called neuronal crosstalk. Neuronal crosstalk. For example, you are a pediatrician. Supposing you are asked to work in an adult ward on a temporary basis. You may always be tempted to ask about natal history, antenatal history, immediate postnatal history in a 65-year-old man. He will not know, because that's the way you are trying. Whereas if we are posted in pediatric ward, we may never ask them. Yes. You understand? So neuronal crosstalk is indicative of repair. So one fiber is destroyed. So another fiber is trying to compensate. For example, if a large myelinated fiber is destroyed and a small myelinated fiber is trying to repair the damaged sensory fiber, peripheral receptor may be proprioceptive receptor, but central pathways are pain pathways. So whenever the repair is done by a fiber of different caliber, so when you touch, what it knows it is doing. So it will carry that sensation and tell that I have been pricked. So that indicates repair has started. So dysesthesia is a better sign. It indicates that repair is going on. So that is dysesthesia. Hyperalgesia is lowered sensory threshold for pain appreciation, which can be psychic, neural, or chemical.
Okay.
So would you like to tell what is psychic, neural, chemical? No. So as we say, the pain pathways go from the large myelinated fiber, small myelinated fiber, A delta fiber, and the C fiber. They ascend through the peripheral nerves. It goes to the root. It relates in the dorsal horn, the dorsal root ganglia, then goes to the dorsal horn. In the dorsal horn, you have got the rexed laminae, of which, with reference to sensation, lamina 2 and lamina 5 are important. One has substance P, another one has got endorphin. So peripherally, I said large myelinated fiber is modulating the small myelinated fiber, triaging unwanted sensory inputs from reaching. And then in the dorsal root ganglion, and when it enters, there is a rexed lamina where there is a chemical modulation. Endorphins are lowering the pain perception, whereas substance B is increasing the pain perception. So these two chemicals are modulated in such a way that you get only what you need. And just before that, there is substantia gelatinosa or Rolandi. There again, second level of filtering is taking place. That is what called gate control theory of Melsack and Wald. So first is large fiber inhibiting small fiber. Then in the substance of gelatinosa rolandi, there is a gating mechanism by which large unwanted stimuli are second level filtered. Third level is chemical filtration between endorphin and substance P. Then they are ascending. Large myelinator through the posterior column and the small myelinator through the spinothalamic tract. And then they go ascend to the thalamo-mesencephalic junction. In the thalamo-mesencephalic junction, you know the periacetyl gray is having endorphins. You know, periacetyl gray has a lot of endorphin. Yes. That is the fourth level of triaging. Again, prevents unwanted sensations. So that is by the descending analgesic path, algesic pathways from the analgesic pathway from the periacetyl gray. Then they are organized into three groups. One is called thalamic component. Second is the subthalamic component. And third is the limbic component. Thalamic component goes to the ventral posterior lateral nucleus thalamus to the sensory cortex for sensory appreciation. Why do you appreciate sensation? You put your hand in the fire, you know it is going to be harmful. So you have to protect yourself. So sensory appreciation is done. How are you going to protect? So the subthalamic component is coming. From the subthalamic nucleus, it goes to the motor cortex, from where sensory motor association is taking place, and you withdraw your limb. To withdraw your limb, you need motor activity.
Yes, ma'am.
So thalamic component goes to the sensory cortex. Subthalamic component goes to the motor cortex to help you to withdraw. And limbic component, supposing that is that you may write already, that you too, Brutus and all, Julius Caesar story, if you read it. When that Brutus stabbed Julius Caesar, I think I'm correct. I don't know if read long back. he will tell, you are also stabbing me. So you are also stabbing me. That is the one which will hurt you. How can you stab me? I loved you so much. No? That is a limbic component. So you got a sensory component, motor component, and a limbic component. Limbic component produces affect. For example, the war wounds are painless if they are in the chest. You have fought in the war in front, and so everybody is thinking that you fought for your country. When you come back, you will be given lot of rewards, prizes. So those people will sit on the lion or elephant and come jumping. They are not painful because of the limbic component. But supposing you are told you are having cancer, then everything is going to be painful. Because you know that what awaits you at the end is a bad thing. So lower threshold can be psychic. That is a limbic component may be operating. Now, then you experience more pain. Or it may be neural where there is a modulatory failure, which may be either the large myelinated fiber destruction or small myelinated fiber irritation or imbalance between endorphins and substance P or defective gating and the substantia gelatinosa. That is hyperalgesia. So now our patient has got paresthesia. So it may be destructive disease of the large myelinated sensory fiber or irritative disease of the small myelinated fiber. And where is it happening? Next question, where is? So now you know it's a large myelinated fiber destruction or small myelinated fiber irritation. That's all you know. Where? Is it in the peripheral nerve? Is it in the root? Is it in the plexus? Or is it in the column? You straight away went to the column. No, you told it is in the posterior column. So then the anatomy will be in a one location. So we have to think, is it in the column or not? So now you have got a nerve pattern, you have got a root pattern, you have got a plexus pattern, and you have got a tract pattern.
Yes, ma'am.
So based on that only, you will tell it is in the column or nerve or root. So what will be these patterns? Would you like to tell me what is a nerve pattern, what is a root pattern quickly, and what is a plexus pattern, and what is a tract pattern? Then we will decide.
Root pattern can have radicular pain involvement, ma'am.
Yes.
Then comes spinal nerve pattern. It can have, this can be associated with other motor and autonomic symptoms also. Then comes the root pattern. Then
first start peripheral nerve.
Okay.
From there only we will follow a pattern so that it is easy for you to have a mathematical order in the neurons. Okay. Nervous system is a mathematical system. If you know the tables, you will solve the problem. No? Yes. So, so peripheral nerve will be generally distal symmetrical.
Yes, ma'am.
So you will ask the patient, was it distal and symmetrical? If it is distal and symmetrical, it is peripheral nerve. If it is distal and asymmetrical, it may be mononeuritis. So in the peripheral nerve, two things. Is it a distal symmetrical neuropathy or is it a mononeuritis? So if it is mononeuritis, in the leg you have got sciatic nerve, you have got sural nerve, you have got saphenous nerve, femoral nerve, obturator nerve. So it is respecting any of the individual nerve pattern, then you will think it is a mononeuritis.
Okay.
Or if it is symmetrical, then you know that it is a distal symmetrical peripheral nerve pattern. So these are the two peripheral nerve pattern. Next, as you said, nerves will have nerve pattern of sensory symptoms, positive or negative. And they sometimes, if it is mononeuritis, you can have a phenomenon called Tinel sign. Supposing you sit on your common peroneal nerve and paralyze that, you tap on the neck of the fibula, you'll get a pain. That is called a Tinel sign. Yes. So if it is mononeuritis, you may get a Tinel sign. Then as you said, if you go to the roots, if it is at the level of the roots, you'll have root pains.
Yes.
Root pains are shock-like, sudden shock-like pains along the distribution of a root. And it will have a precipitating factor like coughing, straining, weightlifting, bending, something like that. And it will have a relieving factor. Whereas a nerve pain has paresthesia, dysesthesia, but no definite precipitating or relieving factor except the Tinel sign. When you tap, it may produce pain. Whereas roots will have coughing, sneezing, weightlifting, bending. All this will produce the pain. And when you lie still, generally the pain disappears. So that is the root. And the distribution will be root. So you should know the radicular pattern of sensory supply in the lower limbs. That is L1 is the groin level, L2 is the mid thigh, L3 is the lower thigh, which goes below the knee. And L4 is medial side of the leg. And L5 is lateral side of the leg across the angle to the big toe. So it is oblique. And S1 will be lateral side of the dorsum, plantar surface of the feet, and back of the leg. And S2 is back of the thigh, and rest is perianal area. So I am only telling because within the limited time, I want to give you the mathematics. That is why. You can discuss if you wish, but I am quickly answering because to limit the time. Is it all right?
Yes, ma'am. This is better, ma'am.
Okay. So you understood the radicular sensory supply, no? L1 upper thigh, L2 mid thigh, L3 is lower thigh below the knee joint, L4 is medial side of the leg, L5 is lateral side of the leg across the angle to the big toe. It is oblique, no?
Mm.
Then S1 is lateral part of the dorsum, plantar surface of the feet and back of the leg. S2 is back of the thigh and rest is perianal. So it may be in any one of these distribution. It will be in a root distribution, sharp, shock-like pain with precipitating factor and relieving factor, that is root. Third is the plexus. So plexus pain will be in the location of the plexus. For example, in a child, I have seen children who have undergone appendicectomy or diverticulitis diagnosed because they have a lumbosacral plexopathy starting and the child presents with pain in the iliac fossa. You may think it is appendicitis. And following surgery for appendicitis, child develop paralysis, surgeon will be sued. Actually, the child never had appendicitis. It was a plexus pain. Plexopathy was evolving. And the weakness came later. So it might have nothing to do with appendicitis. So plexus pain will be in the location of the plexus. And it will radiate along multiple nerves which come from the plexus. Whereas a classical mononeuritis will be one nerve. It may be obturator nerve. It may be femoral nerve. But plexopathy means you will have pain in the iliac fossa. Plus, it may radiate along the medial part of the thigh and anterior part of the thigh. So, two nerves, femoral nerve and obturator nerve. So, classical features of plexus pain is in the location of the plexus. It is not at all sharp. It has no precipitating factor. no relieving factor, and it radiates along more than one nerve, which comes from the plexus. Am I clear, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Then we will go to the tract.
Right.
So what are all the tracts which produce pain? Two tracts. You have got spinothalamic tract, and you have got a posterior column. What is posterior column? It is a proprioceptive tract. So it carries position sense. So it will be containing spindle afferents from the muscle spindle, which convey position of the body parts as well as sensory afferents. So it gets gross sensory afferents with reference to vibration, position, and spindle afferents. Because muscle spindle maintain posture, posterior column senses posture. So it will contain spindle afferents. So why I am telling this? To understand the tract pain. So posterior column tract pain, one typical character is a deep boring paresthesia, as if the muscles are being pulled out from the bone, flesh is pulled out from the bone, because the spindle afferent, which comes from the muscles, are getting irritated. So one type of posterior column tract pain is a deep boring paresthesia, as if the flesh is pulled out from the bone, very deep pain, one. Second is a Larmid sign, classical Larmid sign, all of you know. Whenever the neck is flexed, you get a shock-like pain along the spine. So that is a second posterior column pain. Third kind of posterior column pain is girdle sensation. Girdle sensation is a tight band-like feeling which is spread over the thoracolumbar region. Patient will tell, I feel as if a towel is tied around my chest. Very broad band-like sensation. So one is Larmid sign. Second is girdle sensation. And third is a deep boring paresthesia. And fourth is lightning pains. You might have heard of lightning pains of tabes dorsalis or pseudo tabes of diabetes. These are sudden pains which will come as a crisis. You call them as visceral crisis, stabbing pain in the thorax. You may think the aorta dissected, or sudden pain in the abdomen. You will think that there was a perforation. So that kind of, that is called lightning pains. That is the fourth tract pain. And the fifth tract pain is ill-defined glove and stocking. So normal glove and stocking, which we find in a peripheral nerve disease, will be distal and symmetrical, length dependent. Whereas in posterior column, it is non-length dependent. So in one leg, it may be up to the ankle. In another leg, it may be up to the hip. And when you unlike the classical peripheral nerve glove and stocking, the reflexes will be preserved. Whereas in peripheral nerve, reflexes will be absent. So the five posterior column pains are deep boring paresthesia, asymmetrical bizarre glove and stocking with retained reflex, Larmid sign, lightning pains, and the girdle sensation. So these are the posterior column tract pains. None of them are there in your patient. So you should not be putting it in the posterior column.
Yes.
Whereas spinothalamic tract pain is pain and temperature. Spinothalamic tract is carrying pain and temperature. So it will be superficial burning paresthesia or superficial feeling of cold. No precipitating factor, no relieving factor present all the time. So that is spinothalamic tract pain. So you understood all the positive sensations and their pathomechanisms. No?
Yes.
So now putting all this together, my patient has got a paresthesia which is in the both feet.
Yes, ma'am.
Symmetrical, apparently from the history.
Yes,
so probably it is a large myelinated fiber disease involving the proprioceptive fibers in the peripheral nerve.
Yes.
Most probably. And irritative disease of the small fibers can present like this, but it is less common. Most common is destruction of the large myelinated fiber. So it is the peripheral nerve. It is not in the root. It is not in the plexus. It is not in the tract for points which I have told you. Is it clear to all of you?
Yes, ma'am. Understood, ma'am. Clearly.
Yes. So it is now in the peripheral nerve. It is not even a mononeuritis. It is distal symmetrical. So it is like a peripheral nerve, probably a large myelinated fiber destructive disease, as it is more common than irritative disease of the small fiber in acute presentation.
Yes.
Second, you told my patient developed weakness.
Yes.
The weakness was in the form of first getting up from the sitting posture.
Yes, ma'am.
That is what you told, no? So would you like to analyze that symptom?
Yes, ma'am. Weakness, it was both proximal and distal, bilateral symmetrical weakness, ma'am, which has acutely in the 2 days, ma'am.
Yes. How will you elaborate that symptom like the way we discussed the sensory symptom, no? Because if you, I want you to learn the alphabet, so anywhere you can apply. Yes. So now no more you will tell a distal sensation like this as coming from the posterior column. I am sure of that, no?
Yes.
Like that. You said distal and proximal. That's okay. The first symptom was getting up from the sitting posture. It was difficult. No.
Yes, ma'am.
It is very, very important in children. So getting up from the sitting posture, what are all the muscles that are involved?
So the, ma'am, the proximal muscles are involved, ma'am.
Name them, name them.
And the hamstring muscle.
You see, when you have a motor activity, you have got agonist, you have got antagonist, you have got synergist, you have got fixators, you see. Okay. So agonist is the one which will be the most affected muscle. Antagonist, synergist and fixator having only supporting activity. So getting up from sitting posture, what are the agonist? I want you to tell the agonist for getting up from the sitting posture.
I'm confused, ma'am.
Don't get confused. Imagine you are sitting with your legs crossed.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. If you want to get up, you need your spine extensors. Your spine should be erect.
Yes, ma'am.
Next, you need the hip extensor. You see to elevate your pelvis.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
You know your knee extensor because knee has to go up.
Yes,
thigh
ma'am.
Has to go up. And you have to stabilize your ankle. You need the dorsiflexus of the ankle.
Yes, ma'am.
Very simple. You see? For agonist for getting up from the sitting posture is spine extensor, hip extensor, knee extensor, and dorsiflexor of the ankle. So now we want to know, because to characterize the disease, the first thing we thought probably it is a peripheral nerve distribution, probably a large fiber destruction. Okay, that is the inference from the first symptom. Second symptom, large group of muscles. It may be spine extensor, it may be hip extensor, it may be knee extensor, it may be dorsiflexor of the ankle. Are they all together involved or one by one involved? How are you going to analyze? So, supposing you want to get up from the sitting posture, in our places, I am a Tamil Nadu, in our places, we sit in the floor and make flowers in the evening for puja. People sit for half an hour, 1 hour, no? After that, when we get up, normally what we do? People sit with the legs stretched, they bring their legs under the thighs. Flex your legs and bring it under the thigh. Then put the both hands on the side. Plant both hands on the side. And get up with the pelvis down, end block. We'll get up, hands are on the side. Your pelvis will be down, your trunk will be up, and you get up end block.
Yes, ma'am.
That is the way normally we get up. Supposing you have got a problem of the distal muscle, patient will not be able to spontaneously flex his legs or so he will use his hand and flex the legs, he or she, whoever it is, flex the legs and bring it under the thighs. That depends on how much is the weakness. If the limb is very stiff, they may not be, upper motor neuron also, they may not be able to get up. If it is very stiff, even with their hands, they will not be able to flex. They will say, my leg is feeling like an iron pillar. You will have to help me. But if it is a flail weakness, patient will use the hands and bring it under the thigh. So he will say, okay, when I am sitting on the floor, instead of spontaneously flexing my leg and bringing it under the thigh, I have to use my hand. That indicates some distal muscles are involved, probably. That we will use other symptoms to finalize. Then when you are getting up, you see you may have hip extensor weakness, knee extensor weakness, or spine extensor weakness, or all of them may be weak. If you have hip extensor weakness, with the normal spine extensor. That is the commonest thing. Normally, early only, you don't get spine extensor weakness, which is a late stage of muscle diseases or radiculopathies. It comes much later. So let us imagine the commonest situation where the hip extensor, or as you rightly said, the proximal muscle of the leg, the hip extensor is paralyzed or weak, and the spine extensor is normal. As all of you know, erector spinae has an origin from the iliac crest also. It is not only from the pedicle of the vertebra and the ligaments around there, but it is having an origin from the iliac crest. So that can be used by the body to lift the leg. Next time when you go and see a child with muscle disease, you see. So what will the person do with a proximal muscle weakness or the hip extensor or the weakness of the gluteus maximus, which is the hip extensor, the proximal muscle? What the patient will do is he will use the spine extensor to lift the leg. So if the spine extensor is to use for lifting the leg, for example, if I want to tell, now when I am here, I cannot be inside my house. So like that, when the spine extensor is trying to lift the hip extensor, it cannot be extending the spine. I said, when we get up from the floor, normally we planned our hands on the side and get up en bloc with the pelvis down. Pelvis will be down and spine will be up. If the erector spinae is utilized to lift the pelvis, patient will switch off the spine extensor action of the erector spinae. So what will the patient do? He will bend. Next time you see, it's very, very classical. We have to observe it, that's all. So you can never imitate that. So patient will bend, putting off the erector spinae's action of erecting the spine. And instead of the pelvis being down, your own patient may be having, this patient may be having it. And his pelvis will go up. Normally we get up with a N block. Pelvis is down, spine is up. Whereas if the hip extensor is weak, patient will bend the spine so that he gives leave for the erector spinae from erecting the spine. Pelvis and he is, and it will pull up the leg, pull up the hip. So hip will go up. So when a patient says, I have difficulty in getting up from the floor, you have to ask all these things. Did you have difficulty in flexing your leg? Did you use your hand? No. Then distal is fairly better. And what did you do? Did you bend down? That is called hip up sign. So it cannot be imitated. A hip up sign is very diagnostic of gluteus maximus weakness. So patient gets up with the trunk bent and hip up. That is called hip up sign. Then what he does? Now he will have to stabilize the leg and erect the spine. If you want to walk, you have to erect your spine. So you can stand by locking your bones. You can lock your tibia and the femur by the ligaments and stand on them. You cannot walk, but you can stand. So patient will try that. What will the patient do first? Slowly put one hand on the one knee and another hand on the floor. So initially hip is up, both hands are apparently towards the floor. Now slowly one hand is put on the knee and another hand is in the floor. So you are standing on two legs and one hand. That is called tripod sign. Tripod, you are standing like a tripod. And after the tripod is your famous Gower sign. After tripod, you have stabilized one knee. Then you fix it there and put the other hand slowly on the opposite knee. And then slowly erect your trunk and stand on your bones. So that is Gower sign. So you should ask whether the patient could flex the legs. And did he have hip up sign? Did he have tripod sign? Did he have Gober sign? So if there was hip up sign, that definitely indicate the glutei was weak, but erector was normal. But if the erector was also weak, patient cannot use the hip up sign. If the erector was also weak, if both are paralyzed, he will have to be pulled up. From the sitting posture, you have to pull up the patient. If both erector and the glutei are weak, patient will have to be pulled up. Now you are stood up, and now you want to walk. When you start walking, you said your patient buckled. You said that your patient buckled.
Yes.
That means the knee extensor is weak. So apparently, your patient definitely has weakness of knee extensor. But whether it is hip extensor plus spine extensor, all that, you have to give us the information. You gave information that he buckled. While standing up, after standing up, you need your cruciate ligaments, you need your semilunar cartilages, and you need your quadriceps. If ligaments are weak, you will have a painful buckling. Because ligaments are pain sensitive. Whereas if you have muscle weakness, you will have painful painless buckling. So getting you from the sitting posture, was it through hip up, all these phenomena, if you have got information, you will know which one. Clearly, we know quadriceps is weak because he is buckling.
Yes, but it was painless, ma'am. There was no pain.
Yes, so it's not the ligament. It is quadriceps. So what are weakness from the symptom of getting up from the sitting posture? Clearly, he's having quadriceps weakness. So that is a second structure. Others, we need little more data. Next case, you'll ask like this, whether hip up, gavars, all those things were there or not.
Yes, ma'am.
Then you told you had difficulty in climbing up.
Yes.
You said like that, huh?
Yes,
how did you analyze that symptom? Is it going to help us to pick up the next motor structure? Now we have distal, symmetrical, proprioceptive, sensory fibers. Second, motor, quadriceps is clearly involved. Others we have to sort out. Climbing up is difficult, you told. What was the difficulty, ma'am?
Ma'am, this all happened like in a day, ma'am.
True, but you can ask now. You can ask, you may not get the data because patient may not be that observant. But you are asking, it reflects your knowledge. And in a given case, all the information may be available. So you should ask and say, my patient did not tell me. Madam, I asked all this.
Yes.
So that is very useful. So you can have difficulty in climbing, climbing up. If you have, normally when you want to climb up, what we do? We abduct our leg and put it on the step above. So put it on the step above, you need the hip flexors, hip abductors, and hip extensor. So if the hip flexor, which is a hip flexor? You have to ask, ma'am. Because patient evolved through 2 days, no?
Yes, ma'am. I should have asked, ma'am. I didn't
ask. No, it may not be there in your exam. Of course, you are small, you are first year only, doesn't matter. But you will understand that in 1 out of 1,000 cases, you may diagnose a rare disease. If you go in a systematic pattern, there is no substitute for clinical neurology. No laboratory will help you if you do not have a proper clinical assessment.
Okay.
So there is something called selectivity. Iliosis is affected in some condition, or abductor is affected in some condition. So by that pattern, you will make a pathological diagnosis. So if the hip flexor is weak, then the patient wants to put the leg on the step above. He will use his hand. He will lift his thighs with the hand and put it on the step above. So the patient will tell in the initial few days, when I had to climb the step alternatively, I am unable to do alternate climbing. Young people will do quick alternate climbing and quick alternate climbing up and down. When I tried to do quick alternate climbing, I found it difficult. So I have to use my hands and lift my thigh and put it on the step above. If the patient says that he did it, you know that hip flexor was weak. That is iliopsoas. If the hip abductor was weak, what will happen? It is when the abduction will be weak. So normally you are not you abduct and lift. If that abduction is not taking place, it's a muscle which maintains the tender lumbar. When you lift, abduct, that hip will go up and it gets abducted. If that is not happening, that hip will come down. So when the patient tries to abduct and put the thigh on the step above, that sinks down. That is called a hip dip sign. These are all named signs. Hip dip. So if the patient says, okay, I am having difficulty. The difficulty is not in putting my leg on the step above. I don't use my hand. But when I lift my leg, that hip comes down. So I sag. That results in waddling. That is called hip dip sign. And if these two are not there, but patient has to use the help of the side rail and slightly bend and move up. That means it is the glutei. Already he has got difficulty in getting up. Maybe it is the glutei, because if he did not tell that other, he was needing to be pulled up. No, he was having difficulty in getting up, but he did not tell that he had to be pulled up. In that case, maybe it was a hip extensor. So if it was hip extensor, patient will hold on to the side rails and climb. Understood. So hip flexor, you will put your, take your thighs on your hand and put it on the step above and then climb. Alternate climbing will not be possible. If it is hip abductor, there will be Tendelenburg effect, resulting in that pelvis going down. That is called hip dip sign. If it is only the extensor, then he will hold on to the side rail and climb with a slightly bent trunk, because the erector spinae is helping again. So like the hip up sign where the trunk is completely bent, this patient will stoop slightly forward and he will climb up with a holding on to side rail. So now apparently he has gluteus maximus and quadriceps weakness from the history, I think so. Others, we will clarify in your subsequent cases so that we can spot the muscles. Next, you told his chappal was slipping. You told, no?
Yes, ma'am.
You told chappal slipping.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
Yes. So the chappal slipping, again, you have to analyze like this. When you put a chappal in your feet, there are so many things. You find your chappal, you take your feet and put it into the chappal. So yes, to put into the chappal, what do? You have to separate your toes. Then only your chappal will properly fit into your feet. Mm-hmm. After that, you have to bring your toes close.
Yes, ma'am.
Then hold on and walk. So supposing you have got a spastic leg, there is something called kinetic malady or fine tuning of a motor activity. So fine tuning of a motor activity is correctly coordinating agonist, antagonist energies so that the motor activity is going on well. That is movement. Movement control. It is not muscle control, it's movement control. So in upper motor neuron, there is loss of kinetic malady. Movement control is not good. So patient will have difficulty in separating the toes properly. One will be separated, another one will not be separated. So he will have difficulty in putting his feet into the chappal. Because somewhere it will not go there, he will use his hand. Then next, it will not come closer when he wants it to come closer. So he will have difficulty in holding on and walking. Then when he wants to remove the feet from the chappal, again all the toes will not separate. One will separate, another will not separate. So somewhere it will be stuck. So all three phases of putting on the chappal, holding on and walking, and removing the feet from the chappal, all are weak means it is a movement control problem. Kinetic malady is abnormal. So it is upper motor neuron. So my patient cannot put his feet into the chappal. He cannot hold on and walk. He cannot even remove the chappal. All are having half a sod. So movement control is poor. That is upper motor neuron.
Okay.
Supposing it is lower motor neuron. What are the lower motor muscles? The intraosseous. So the intraosseous are weak. The toes are always separated. So putting on the chappal into the feet is easy. Space is more. So he'll put it on. But he cannot bring it closer. So putting on the chappal is easy. Holding on and walking is difficult. Removing the chappal is again easy because it is always separated. Did you understand, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
All three phases means it is kinetic malady or movement control. Movement control problem is upper motor neuron. So upper motor neuron, all will be abnormal. lower motor neuron always separated. So he can put his feet into the chappal easily. He cannot hold on and walk.
That was only the problem. It was slipping out after once he wanted to walk.
Yes. Then it may be a small muscles. Let us come to that. Third, it will be removing will be easy. Now he already has got a sensory impairment. So is it the sensation that is affecting? That also can do. If it is a sensation, he can put the feet into the chappal. He can hold the chappal. He can remove the chappal. But because the proprioceptive information is needed for this, not just motor, patient has to fix his eye on the feet. So if the patient says, I can do everything well, but if I remove my eye from the feet, it slips off. I don't know why it is my chappal. I walk forward. Chappal slips off. That is sensory. All three are all right, provided your vision is fixed on the feet. If the vision is fixed on the feet, I am all right. If I lift up my head, it slips off. That is sensory. So he has sensory already. So does he have this complaint that he has to look at his feet and put on the chappal? So is it purely the motor component that is operating, or it's a sensory component is also operating, or is it purely sensory? That's a question we have to answer. So it asks, how is there any difficulty if he feeling better when he fixes his gaze on the feet? If he says, okay, I have some difficulty, but I am worst when I am removing my gaze, then it is sensory motor.
Okay.
If it is purely element motor, as you said, it will be second part where he can put it on, but he cannot hold on and walk. So far we find that there is glutei, quadriceps, plus minus small muscles. Small muscles, whether it is sensory or motor, we have to take little more history from the patient. So it may be sensory, mixed or motor, we don't know, because already sensory is there. And you have got a distal symmetrical sensory impairment. So what about the upper limbs, ma'am?
From upper limbs, all the functions are fine, ma'am.
Normal. Does he have any cranial nerve symptom?
No cranial nerve symptoms are present.
So now would you like to tell me what are all the structures involved in this patient? What are all the structures involved in this patient, ma'am? No, summarize.
Like by the history, if we go, it is the peripheral nerve that is being involved, ma'am, with the sensory symptom which he had, and along with the distal and proximal muscle involvement, mostly it is the peripheral nerve that is being involved in our patient.
So if you say peripheral nerve, everything is very typical or something is atypical? You see, something is atypical, no? Because he has so much of proximal weakness. He is unable to get up at all from the sitting posture. No, by 2 days, he is unable to get up at all.
Yes,
whereas sensory is only distal. Sensory is only distal.
Yes.
So what you have to tell my patient, sensation is distal in a peripheral nerve pattern. But the motor is more proximal. And distal is kori-kori. Distal sensory is kori-kori. Whereas distal motor is less. Distal motor is kori, distal sensory is clear. And proximal motor is very severe. Proximal sensory is not there. Proximal sensory is not there. So that is the unusual feature for a classical peripheral nerve. So how are you? It is going to give us a clue. So now what is happening proximally? Proximally, so that is not a typical nerve pattern. It may be a radicular pattern. So proximal muscles, that is a hip extensor, hip abductor, knee extensor are more involved. Classically, if it is a nerve, it should be distal muscle weakness and very little proximal muscle weakness. or the proximal muscle weakness should be as much as the sensory and motor should correlate. If sensory and motor are correlating, it is typically a peripheral nerve. Second, if you say peripheral nerve, by the time the knee is reached, upper limb should be involved. Upper limb is not involved. So length dependent peripheral neuropathies, by the time the knee is reached, the upper limb will be involved. So upper limb is not involved so far, even though patient is very weak and paralyzed. So it is not a nerve pattern. So sensory is nerve. Motor, is it nerve or not, is a question mark. So if you want to explain an element syndrome where there is a significant proximal motor and sensory is not correlating and distally sensory, then you will have to invoke motor radicals.
Okay, ma'am.
Motor radicals. It's not a nerve. So this looks like a motor radiculopathy and a sensory neuropathy. So that's the only way you can explain. If it's a length-dependent neuropathy, the upper limb distal, by the time your knee is reached, the upper limb will get involved. That has not become involved. And motor is significant, sensory is distal. So it's not respecting the length. It is not respecting the length-dependent pattern which you see in a typical peripheral neuropathy. So it is a motor radiculopathy and a sensory neuropathy or a radiculoneuropathy. So it looks like a radiculoneuropathy.
Okay.
So that is the first diagnosis. And you think it's an element. So if you think it is a motor root and sensory nerve, and the motor root is more proximal and sensory nerves are distal, what is common between both of them? It is myelin. You see, you have got large myelinated fibers, you have got small myelinated fibers, and you have got unmyelinated fiber. Unmyelinated fiber is the C fiber that is not involved in this case.
And we
thought that the distal is probably proprioceptive, and that's a large myelinated fiber. And motor fibers are large myelinated fibers. And autonomic is, and pain and temperature are small myelinated. And C fiber is unmyelinated. So large myelinated is motor and proprioceptive. Pain and temperature and autonomic is myelinated, but it is less myelinated than proprioceptive and motor. And C fiber is unmyelinated. And the roots are more myelin than nerves. In the motor, the roots are more myelin. The proximal roots are more myelin. As it goes down and down, the myelin becomes less and less. So this seems to be a disease where both the sensory fibers and the motor fibers are involved, and the pattern of involvement points to myelination. So it has not involved the autonomic fibers. It has not involved the small pain and temperature fibers. Patient is not having any burning pain. Patient is not having any feeling of cold, but he's having tingling and he's having weakness. So two types of fibers seem to be involved, proprioceptive fibers and motor fibers. And the pattern of involvement, where is the myelin distributed? Motor fibers, myelin more in the proximal roots. Sensory fibers, it is fairly uniform. So it seems to target myelin. So it's a radiculoneuropathy, proximal motor more than distal motor, and distal sensory more than proximal sensory. That pattern is typical of myelin-associated disorders. So probably it is a demyelinating radiculoneuropathy. You understood, ma'am? Supposing you have got a vasculitis, they prefer the small fibers, pain, temperature, autonomic fibers. Whereas toxic diseases, they involve the pain and temperature and spare the autonomic. Except some exceptions like thallium and all. So it is looking like a radiculoneuropathy and targeting the myelin. So probably it's a demyelinating radiculoneuropathy. So that is, if the sensations were not involved, for a pediatrician, you should always consider, this boy has crossed that age group, I think, but still you'll have to consider a polio or polio-like illness. So what will be the pattern if that is the case, ma'am? Let us imagine my patient does not have any sensory. So what is the pattern you will find?
Bilateral symmetrical loss of the muscle.
Yes. First you should tell there will be no sensory.
Okay.
So if it is polio or polio-like illness, Ecovirus, Epstein-Barr virus can produce polio-like illness. So there will be no sensory at all. So it will be purely motor. Second, like a demyelinating radiculoneuropathy, it can be proximal, distal, bulbar, cranial nerves, trunks, upper limb, everything can be involved. So that will not help you to differentiate in a given case. Third, respiration can be involved. Pain, severe pain. Sensory tingling will not be there, but muscle pain will be there. So that is there both in demyelinating radiculoneuropathies and acute polio. So that doesn't help you. But there is a pattern called column pattern. You have got short column muscles and long column muscles. For example, if you take short muscles of the foot, it's a short column muscle. It is coming from S2 segment alone. If you take thigh muscles, it's a long column muscle, L1, L2, L3. What is the radical root value of quadriceps if you ask? L1, L2, L3 will tell. It's a long column muscle. So column pattern is typical of anterior consult disease. What is that pattern? Short column muscles, if they are involved, they are severely involved. Because one anterior consult at one segment, it is completely knocked off. Whereas long column muscles, if they are involved, they are mildly involved. Because L2, L3, L4 is there. And L3 and L4 will support. You understand? So yes. One, if you want to tell the differentiation between an acute anterior horn cell disease and an acute radiculoneuropathy, one acute anterior horn cell disease is purely, what is common is pain in the muscles, rapid progression, bulbar involvement, fever at the onset, all this can be common. Even though one will be GIT, another will be respiratory, all those things. But GIT can happen in both. So preceding infection can be there in both. But rapid progression, bulbar involvement, respiratory involvement, all can be there in all. But sensory will not be there in anterior horn cell. Sensory is there in some form or other, even though mild, in radiculoneuropathies. Third point, it is a radiculoneuropathy pattern in radiculoneuropathies. Whereas in polio, it is a column pattern. Short column muscles are severely involved. Long column muscles are mildly involved. Because so many segments are there, they will maintain it. Third point will be, neck stiffness may be present in anterior consult disease, acute poliomyelitis or acute polio-like illness, producing a anterior horn cell involvement. It's a meningitis. I am sure you know it's a meningitis. You are a pediatrician. So there can be neck stiffness. Neck stiffness is never there in radiculoneuropathies. Okay. Then if you do CSF, you find cellular CSF in
polio
and polio-like illness. Whereas cytoalbuminuric reversal in radiculoneuropathies. And if you do nerve conduction studies, nerve conduction will be abnormal in radiculoneuropathies. It will be normal in anterior horn cell disease. EMG will be abnormal in both. So normal nerve conduction, abnormal EMG is radiculoneuropathy. Normal nerve conduction, abnormal EMG is anterior horn cell disease. Whereas both are abnormal is radiculoneuropathy. So now our patient seems to have a demyelinating radiculoneuropathy, which has not so far affected the trunk or the upper part of the body. Yes, is it acute, subacute or chronic, ma'am?
Ma'am, this is acute, ma'am.
Yes. What is the timeline criteria?
Less than 4 weeks is acute. Yes. Less than 8 weeks is chronic, ma'am. So 4 to 8 will be subacute.
So more than 8 is chronic. 4 to 8 is subacute. Less than 4 is acute. So it's an acute element syndrome. Radiculoneuropathy, probably demyelinating. It was preceded by a respiratory infection.
Yes, ma'am.
So it could be a AADP.
Yes, ma'am.
At this point, I will tell you one formula for approach to this kind. It is called 3-6-10 pattern. Okay. You heard of that?
No, ma'am, I have not heard of this.
You have got three goals. It is there in the literature. You can refer. Three goals. Is my patient having element syndrome or not? So flaccid limb, not at all stiff, no bladder. So does he have an element syndrome or not? And if he has an element syndrome, what is it? And third, is it treatable? These are the three goals. So now we know our patient has got an element syndrome. Yes. It looks like a radicular neuropathy of demyelinating nature, and it is probably treatable. So these are the three goals. And keeping these three goals, we ask six questions. Six questions is one. This is very useful, ma. First question is, what are the systems involved? Is it purely motor? Is it purely sensory? Is it sensory motor? Is it sensory motor autonomy? So element syndrome is there. In the element, what are involved? So answer that question, it is sensory motor. So you cut off all your other acute flaccid paralysis. It is sensory motor. Second question is, does it have a specific pattern? That is what I analyzed. Specific pattern, distal symmetrical mixer. That is one pattern. Distal sensory motor. So our patient is not having distal sensory motor. He's having distal sensory and proximal motor. So is it a distal symmetrical sensory motor? That is one pattern. Second pattern, is it a distal asymmetrical sensory motor? Then it becomes plexopathies and radicular neuropathies. Third pattern, is it purely sensory? If it is purely sensory, is it symmetrical or asymmetrical? It is large fiber or small fiber. Next, is it purely motor? If it is purely motor, is it distal asymmetrical? Then it comes to the chronic anterior horn diseases, ALS, PMA, all those things. If it is proximal motor, it comes under SMEs. Then midline motor, that will be bulbar palsy, dropped head syndrome of anterior horn cell. So that is a midline motor. So the pattern can be distal symmetrical mixer, or is it distal asymmetrical? Is it purely sensory, symmetrical, asymmetrical? Is it proximal motor? Is it distal motor, asymmetrical? Does it have upper motor neuron? Does it have upper motor? So myelo radicular neuropathies, for example, Sjogren's syndrome or subacute combined degeneration, nutritional, toxic myelopathies, schistosomiasis, those conditions, there will be cord and nerve involvement. So is there any upper motor neuron involvement? Third, fifth question, what is the timeline? Timeline, is it
temporal.
4 weeks, 8 weeks on? Sixth question, is there heredity? Is there a family history? So HNBP can present acutely. Porphyria can present acutely.
That is chronic.
Yes. So these are the six questions. So for three goals, six questions. From this, ask all these six questions. I told you the answers. For each question, I told you. Then that will become the 10 patterns. So my patient has got a hairy family history. He is having upper motor involvement plus lower motor involvement. And he is having distal sensory loss. And he is having myelopathy and peripheral neuropathy. Or he has a chronic neuropathy of distal. So 10 patterns come from these six questions. For each six question, I gave you the answers. And putting all the answers together, you get 10 patterns. Based on that, you make a diagnosis. So if you put that, my patient has got a neuropathy, and the neuropathy seems to have rapid progression. It seems to have sensory motor. It respects the myelin. It is distal sensory proximal motor. And it is acquired because there is no family history. It was preceded by infection.
Yes, ma'am.
So all these points here. So it is called 3-6 pattern approach to peripheral nerve disease.
Yes.
Very, very useful. Because under each category, there are different diseases. Mid-segment involvement, upper segment, lower segment involvement. So 3-6-10 pattern you apply to everyone and then draw the history diagnosis. So history diagnosis reminds radicular neuropathy of demyelinating nature, considering the preceding infection, it can be a AIDP variant. Most probably. So would you like to tell me what are all the AIDPs you know of?
One is Guillain-Barré syndrome.
Yes. Landry-Guillain-Barré syndrome.
Yes. Yes.
Classical one, which will be associated with proximal motor, distal minimal sensory, upper limb and lower limb, with or without respiration and cranial nerves. That's a classical Landry-Guillain-Barré syndrome. What other variants, ma'am? Miller-Fisher. Miller-Fisher. So you have ophthalmoplegia, ataxia, areflexia. Miller-Fisher. Then AMSAM. Then you have got paraplegic variant, more common in younger people. Bibrachial variant and focal variant. It may be like a plexopathy. So now if you put it under what type it is, it looks like a paraplegic variant.
Yes.
Paraplegic variant. So it is radiculoneuropathy, demyelinating, paraplegic variant. So what is the importance of these variants in prognosticating?
AIDP has a good prognosis, ma'am. AMSAN has a bad prognosis.
I agree, AMSAN has got a very... So, axonal variant. So, this is not axonal. This looks like a demyelinating. So, that way it is good. So, our patient, axonal variant will be distal more than proximal. And areflexia will not be there. Distal reflexes is gone. But they will have early fibrillation, fasciculation, wasting, and denervation. So what is the bad prognostic signs are extremes of age. Too young and too old, 3 years or 70 years. So extremes of age, it carries a poor prognosis. Second, descending pattern. That is starting with the craniobulbar muscles and coming down. That carries a bad prognosis. Rapid progression, 24 to 48 hours, that's a bad prognosis. Preceding GIT infection, bad prognosis. Associated autonomic involvement, bad prognosis. Associated respiratory involvement, bad prognosis. Associated hyponatremia, bad prognosis. In our patient, he is not in the extremes of age group, he is in the middle group. He had preceding respiratory infection, that is not that bad. He has no descending pattern. He has no bulbar involvement. He has no respiratory involvement. He has no autonomic features as of now. So all this is good. Only one is bad, rapid progression.
Rapid progression.
So next step, you'll tell my patient seems to have demyelinating, radiculoneuropathy, paraplegic variant of AIDP. All the factors are good. Even the demyelinating variant is going to have good prognosis. Only one bad point is rapid progression. So this is your history diagnosis. Now you examine, tell me. So we want to confirm whether anything extra is there, any autonomic is there, any cranial nerve is there, like that.
On examination, the boy is conscious, cooperative, well oriented to time, place and person. He looks well nourished. The boy has been brought in a wheelchair as he is unable to get up from the sitting position. Parameters are all normal. Doing head-to-toe examination, parallel rectus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy and edema were not present. There were no any neurocutaneous markers or skin lesions present. On doing nervous system examination, higher mental functions were all normal, ma'am. On examination for the cranial nerves.
Yes, tell
me. All the cranial nerve findings were present, ma'am. They were all normal.
What cranial nerves you specifically look for, ma'am?
The lower cranial nerves, ma'am, 9, 10, 11.
Commonly involved cranial nerve is 7th.
7th now.
Whereas CIDPs involve the lower cranial nerves, AIDPs involve the 7th cranial nerve or eye movements. Miller-Fisher variant will be eye movement and 7th nerve is commonly involved. Lower can be involved, but it is more common in CIDP, not in AIDP. The time frame is not for the CIDP. Then you will look for facial sensations if you are thinking of vasculitic neuropathies, Sjogren's and their variants, they are trigeminal. So you will have olfactory nerve involvement in some kind of hereditary neuropathies, Refsum's disease, Shy's and all those things. Second nerve will be involved in mitochondrial neuropathies, NARP. They can have an acute presentation, their there will be second hour involvement. Whereas AIDP used to specifically look at the eye movements and the seventh nerve.
Yes, ma'am.
So they are not involved.
No, okay. Not involved.
Okay, go on.
Coming to the motor examination, the bulk of the muscle seemed normal, ma'am. There was hypotonia and the lower limb muscles were flaccid, ma'am, but the upper limb flexors and extensors were normal. Then power, again, the lower limb, the upper limb power was 5, power was, but coming to the lower limb, again, the power was 0, ma'am.
0, all growths. Yes, okay. Yes, yes.
0 power. Coming to the reflexes, superficial reflexes could be elicited, but the plantar reflex could not be elicited. It was absent. Deep tendon reflex, it was 1 plus in both left and right for the upper limbs, biceps, triceps, and supinator reflex. The knee jerk and the ankle reflex were absent, ma'am. Coordination, lower limbs couldn't be elicited. Upper limbs were normal. There were no involuntary movements present. Sensory system was intact, ma'am. When I examined for fine touch, vibration, and proprioception, it was fine, ma'am.
What you should do in a case like this, ma'am? Because you definitely started with the tingling, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So you should look for timed vibration. Timed vibration and dynamic joint sense. So you should specifically look for that. And you should look for pseudoathetosis when he's lying down. This will indicate whether there is a subtle proprioceptive fiber involvement. It has to be there. Because he started like that. I'll tell you. You have to use the 128 tuning fork. Normally, in a very young, healthy adult like this, in the angle, the vibration will be perceived for 20 seconds. Okay. And in the anterior superior iliac spine, it will be perceived for 25 seconds. And this remains like that up to 40 years. After the age of 40, you lose 1 second per decade normally without any diabetes or no other disease means. Normal loss is 1 second per decade. So with a good proper tuning fork, you should appreciate 20 seconds. He's a very young boy. So he should appreciate 20 seconds. If it is less than 15, it is definitely abnormal for his age. So that is timed vibration. Next is dynamic joint sense. Dynamic joint sense is you look for 1 degree joint movement. He need not tell it is up or down. Did I move it or not? That is 1 degree movement. Young boy like this should appreciate 1 degree movement. That should be looked for. And third is when he's not looking at his feet, is he having a, but the power is grade 0, so pseudoathetosis will not be manifest. If there is a loss of proprioception, they will be slightly moving their toes within the power that is available to understand the position in space. But if the grade is 0, he will not be able to do that. So after examination, what we got extra is, from the history, we thought that it is hip extensor, knee extensor, and plus minus toe grip weakness. Now it appears that there is complete weakness of all the muscles.
Yes, ma'am.
That is the extra you got. He does not have bladder, bowel, nor trunk pattern of sensory loss. So because he started with tingling, in polio and AIDP you can have pain.
Okay.
But pain when you press cues, but you will not have tingling. So tingling definitely indicate proprioceptive fiber involvement. So it's a classical paraplegic variant. That is called paraplegic variant.
Okay.
Only bad sign is you can give him a relatively good prognosis. Everything is good only, except that he has rapid progression that you can tell them. So he may take little more time to recover. The severe weakness in the onset is also a typical feature of demyelination. Whereas axonopathies are distal, but they do not recover. They recover poorly, but demyelinating ones will produce severe conduction block, electrophysiology, that will completely paralyze, but they will recover. So now, what are you going to do for this patient?
This patient investigations, ma'am. We can do now conduction studies.
Yes.
Then we can do lumbar puncture, ma'am.
Yes.
So
nerve conduction study, you have got to do. If it is normal, it is going to tell you you are correct. The sensations are not involved. Probably it's a polio-like illness or polio. We don't know. If the nerve conductions are abnormal, it is radicular neuropathy, what we thought. I am expecting it to be abnormal because it started with tingling.
Yes, ma'am.
Second, as you said, you will do the CSF. So yes, to establish the anatomy, you will do investigation. Second investigation to establish the etiology. So cytoalbuminuric reversal is again establishing the etiology.
Yes,
anatomy by electrophysiology, CSF for the etiology. You don't do the viral antigens normally. You don't do the antibodies normally because they are very costly. And if electrophysiology and CSF is done, it gives you the diagnosis. Was it done in this patient, ma'am?
Ma'am, no, ma'am. It was not done, ma'am. On the day of examination only, like we discharged, ma'am, because of the ongoing COVID. We had to refer, ma'am.
Okay. So demyelinating radiculoneuropathies are treated with plasmapheresis, ideally. 25 to 40 ml per kg can be removed in 5 or 6 settings. Or you can use IVIG. If this weight is less, it is very easy. 2 grams per kg immunoglobulins can be given with physiotherapy, prevention of DVT, prevention of contractures. No?
Okay.
So go and read today the 3-6-10 pattern.
Yes.
That's very useful.
Yes.
And I think we have grossly covered what your case is. And I will teach you in the due course that neurology is anatomy, proper anatomy using the tables.
Yes, ma'am. It will be helpful.
Clubbing it with etiology. I have told you how to analyze getting up from sitting posture, climbing, chapel slipping, all these symptoms I have analyzed that you make a mental arithmetic today.
Yes,
ma'am. And 3-6-10 pattern, you do a mental arithmetic. And in due course, in case God permits me to discuss more cases with all of you,
yes,
we will understand neurology is mathematics.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. As and when time provided, please do come and teach us, ma'am. All of us are eager to learn. Like this, to this extent, localization and all, we have not learnt it till now.
Certainly, I will do it. Yes. Any questions in this case, you can ask me, ma'am.
Ma'am, which is better, ma'am? IVIG or plasma exchange?
You see, both are equally effective. There is no synergistic effect. But if you are using, always use plasmapheresis first. Because if you give plasmapheresis and it doesn't help, you have an option of IVIG. But if you give IVIG first, you cannot do plasmapheresis.
Okay.
Because if you give IVIG and then you do plasmapheresis, you will remove the IVIG. IVIG takes time. So it is said that there is no synergistic effect. Both are equally effective. But some people respond to plasmapheresis better and some people respond to IVIG better. It is always better to do plasmapheresis first because then still another option remains, not to do IVIG first. The comparison and contrast, there is no real difference, but there is an individual difference. In the numbers, yeah, both are effective. Some people do respond to IVIG better. Some people, you cannot determine who is going to respond to what. So always better to do plasmapheresis.
Okay, understood.
Any other question? Today I will request you to refer the 3-6-10 article.
Yes, ma'am. 3-6-10. We have got the link also, ma'am. Here, we have put it up in the chat group. All the participants can.
Any question, ma'am? Anybody has questions, you ask me. Thank you. Any question, ma'am?
Lermit sign, could you please repeat, ma'am? They asked, ma'am.
You see, Lermit sign is a shock like, you see, always we are told that tract pains have no precipitating factor, no relieving factor. One exception is Lermit sign. Larmid sign is having a precipitating factor in the form of bending the neck. When you bend the neck, Larmid sign come. It is a sudden electric shock like pain which travels down the spine when you bend your neck. That is the commonest posterior column tract pain. Other tract pains, I told you, the girdle sensation, lightning pains, deep boring paresthesia from the spindle afferents, as if the muscles are being pulled out from the bones, and a bizarre Glavenstocking, which is not symmetrical. Bizarre Glavenstocking with retained reflex, whereas Glavenstocking in LMN is absent reflex. So these are the classical posterior column tract pains. Any other question, ma'am?
History, how to tell whether it's spastic?
Stenal sign is seen in which neuropathy? I'll tell you, stenal sign, you see, any mononeuritis. Supposing you have got an entrapment of the common peroneal nerve, or entrapment of the ulnar nerve, or entrapment of the tibial nerve. So mononeuritis, you tap along the nerve. Even Hansen's can produce stenal sign. When you reach the point of inflammation or point of irritation, when you tap at that point, you get the pain. So stenal sign is typical of mononeuritis. What other question, ma'am?
Ma'am, in history, how to tell whether it is spastic or flaccid paraplegia? They asked, ma'am.
Spastic, stiff limb, as I told, you see, stiffness will be experienced by the patient. Patient will tell that my limb is stiff, one. So, whereas a flaccid paralysis patient will tell my limb is loose. And stiff limbs are usually heavier. They are more heavy. Because of the, in addition to the weakness, the stiffness also contributes to the disability. So it is heavier. Then third point, as I told, when you are getting up from the floor, at least for some time when the power was retained, a stiff limb patient will not be able to get up at all. Somebody has to pull him up because it will be like a log of wood. You cannot sit with your legs flexed. You sit with your legs extended and somebody has to pull it up. Whereas a fly limb, you can always bring it close to the thighs with your hands. Then, of course, you examine. You can shake the limb or you can pull at the, you give the leg stretch and quickly lift at the, holding at the knee. Then you find the injury stone and you check with the passive movement, and maximum, even minimum stiffness is there. The minimum stiffness in the lower limbs will be manifest in the adductors of the lower limb and pronators of the upper limb. So slightest spasticity, you do quick alternating pronation, supination movement with the upper limb. So pronators of the upper limb and adductors of the lower limb experience upper motor neuron symptom in the form of spasticity earliest. So do quick adduction, abduction movement in the lower limb and quick pronation, supination movement in the upper limb, and look for a pronator catch in the upper limb or adductor catch in the lower limb. Anything else, ma'am?
That's all, ma'am, they were asked for.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Where to refer for three? It's an article, ma'am. You search a three.
It's the article, ma'am.
3610 pattern of peripheral nerve approach. It is there in the, I forgot the name of the author. I read it long back, but it is there. You put, just put 3610 pattern, you'll get it.
Put the article over here.
Okay, very, very good, very good, very good. Okay, thank you. Was it useful, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am, very useful and informative, ma'am. It was, thank you, sir.
I am clinician, so I will tell you the clinical methods. That is, because laboratory, you can always read. Clinical, somebody has to teach you.
Yes, ma'am.
I am thinking that mostly I am making myself free on Wednesdays at this particular time.
Yes, ma'am.
If there is anything difficult, I will always inform. Otherwise, every Wednesday, I am keeping it for the young people of my country. You
people. We'll also come up with different cases, ma'am.
Okay, very good.
By your opinion, what can we present, ma'am? If
any case, ma'am, any case we can discuss. Some cases we will diagnose, some cases we will do differential diagnosis. That's okay, no problem. It's like that, no? Clinically, 90% of the cases can be diagnosed. 10% we can do differential diagnosis. When it becomes differential diagnosis, we will seek the help of the laboratory. That's all, no problem. Any case you can bring, but bring neurology, because even though I have MD, long back I stopped medicine. I never practiced medicine. Yes. I straight went to neurology. So medicine I will not be able to discuss. Yes. I can discuss neurology any case. Yes. Any case you bring, any. Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Thanks.
So much participants.